This is Bob Rourke with Business Leaders Podcast, and today we're on, what floor are we on?
We are, gosh,
on the top 20, floor.
Yeah, yeah. Top floor.
There we go. In downtown Denver with Martin Lanik. He's the CEO of Pinsight and the author of the just released book, The Leader Habit. And that was released last week.
Correct, yes. It just came out last week.
And I had the good fortune of getting a copy before it was released and finished reading it here midweek.
Wonderful.
So, Martin, thank you so much for taking time to be on the podcast.
Yes, happy to be here. Thank you, Bob.
Well, Martin, if you would, tell us a little bit about your business and who you serve.
So, I run a software company called Pinsight, and we focus on leadership development and leadership assessment. So, we work with organizations to help them hire better leaders, and then to promote better leaders, to identify the right high potentials that they should invest in, to develop them and prepare them for executive positions, and then, of course, work with those high potentials as we are developing them.
You know, it's, you know, folks are going, and I'm prior military, so the leadership model was pretty understood and taught and so on. What took you down the path of working on leadership and developing solutions and applications to help?
So I have a background in industrial organizational psychology. Actually, I have a PhD here from Fort Collins, from Colorado State University. And I started very early on in my career focusing on leadership and leadership assessment and development. And then I worked as a consultant out of Pittsburgh and London, working with global organizations, helping them with their leadership strategy. And then when the recession hit, I identified an opportunity. I thought, well, there's an opportunity here in the market where you can take all the really good parts of general leadership programs and then streamline them so they become much more cost effective and scalable globally. That's how I founded Pinsight.
You know, I think about the folks that are listening and they're going, okay, there's a number of leadership programs of one description or another, and for you, in fact, if you would, might I borrow your book, and so for the folks who can take a look at the video, this is what the book looks like, so that's quite cool. So I thought I would do that. So when the folks that are listening, you're just going to have to imagine a book.
Yes.
But it's really module-based inside the book, where you have, you could go through, try to do some work and pick topics and work your way through. What led you basically to the thought process to start chunking it, for lack of a better term?
I think you're absolutely correct. So there's so many different models of leadership and there's so many different solutions out in the market. So what makes our process different is the realization that your traditional classroom-based leadership development just doesn't work. And this was actually why I decided to write the book. So several years ago, I came across an article in the Journal of Consulting Psychology that suggested, or actually showed, that American corporations, year over year, end up spending more and more money on leadership development, to the point that it was about $14 billion in 2012. But our general confidence in leadership is actually decreasing. So there's a negative relationship. We end up spending more on leadership development, but we're less confident in our leaders. So then I started thinking, well, why is this happening? Why aren't we producing better leaders despite all this investment? And what I realized is that majority of leadership development programs really focus on knowledge. So they focus on different, you know, theoretical models of what good leadership should look like, or maybe personal experience of some wonderful leaders. But that does not translate to behavior change. So I started looking at the research in behavior change, and more specifically habits. So how do people develop habits? How do they adopt and internalize behaviors to a point that they are automatic? They do them without thinking. For example, like making your bed in the morning or brushing your teeth, right? You just do that automatically, you don't even think about it. And that's the whole point behind my new book, The Leader Habit. that you practice these effective leadership behaviors that we found through our research, and you practice them to the point that they are your second nature. You just do them automatically. You don't even think about that.
You know, and so for folks, let's head down sort of an illustration. So let's say that I'm a big picture leader, but I'm a horrible detail leader. Mm-hmm. And everybody goes, you know, you're really good at vision and whatnot.
Right.
But you fall off the cliff on the detail execution. Mm-hmm. Inside the book, you went through some exercise there. Could you walk us through that?
Yes, sure. So the first point I would say is you need to be much more specific. So what does it mean from a behavioral standpoint when you say that you're not a detail person? So what is it that you're actually not doing that you should be? And an example that comes to my mind is, for instance, with delegation. So the way you are delegating may not be the way effective and successful leaders delegate. So we can then pinpoint a very specific behaviors. For instance, we found through our research of about 800 leaders around the world that what effective delegation looks like. So effective leaders, when they delegate, they, for instance, match the project to the skill. So this could be an example of why somebody might describe you as not detail oriented, because you just throw projects and tasks at people without thinking about, does the employee have the right set of skills to be successful in this with this project.
There's a series of exercises that you do on a repetitive basis that you talk about.
Yes, and that's exactly how you internalize it. So think about, how do we learn new behaviors? How do we learn to play tennis or football or play a musical instrument? We practice on a daily basis. So if we go with that example of delegation, for instance, so you could build an exercise where 5 minutes a day, when you delegate or when you make the decision to delegate, you write down, you know, what are the two most important skills that are necessary to complete this this project, and then you rate the employee you're thinking to delegate in the project to on where they are, maybe on a scale 1 to 10 on those two skills. And this, if you practice this for 66 days, you internalize it. So after about 2 months, you'll notice that you're automatically, the minute you think, oh, I should delegate this project to Tom over here, you start thinking automatically, what are the skills that are needed to complete this project, and is Tom ready to do that?
You know, for the folks, as an aside, that are listening, you go, he's not from Alabama.
No, Texas, actually.
He's not from Texas either. So you're an exchange student, yes?
Yes, so I was born in Slovakia. Back then it was actually Czechoslovakia. And then I was an exchange student in high school. And I ended up in California. And it was one of those things where, you know, I finished high school, graduated, and then I figured I'm having a really good time here. You know, I was a teenager and, you know, living in Northern California, so I'm going to just try a year of college, see how that goes. And, you know, then another year of college and then graduate school, and next thing you know, it's been 18 years.
You like it.
I did, yeah.
I think about, for the folks that are listening, and they go, well, 66 days, well, why not 72 or 58 or some other number?
That's what the research shows. So the popular belief that you might probably heard about is 21 days, right? That's how long it takes to build a new habit. But when you actually look at where that estimate is coming from, it's coming from a claim that a medical doctor made in the 1960s, he said that it takes a minimum of 21 days for people to get used to change from plastic surgery. And it's very interesting how this became the popular belief that it takes 21 days to build a new habit. But when you actually look at the research literature, it takes on average 66 days for people to internalize new behavior to a point where it becomes automatic and they don't even.
Well, that would explain why the people says 30 days is all it takes. They do it for 30 days and it doesn't stick.
Yes.
And that would explain that very well.
Yes.
And so, you know, for a company, let's say that there's a company and they're listening to this and go, you know, we want to do some leadership development in our company. What should they expect if they reach out to you or if they go to PinSight, and PinSight is PINSIGHT, correct?
Correct, yeah. It stands for People Insight.
People Insight.
Yes. Just combine those two words, that's how we arrived at PinSight.
So what should they expect if they were going to do some leadership development using the tools that you bring to them?
Sure. So we always start with an understanding of the company strategy. So any leadership behaviors or any change in leadership behaviors really needs to support the strategy of the business. So we ask executives generally, what are the 2 to 3 most important strategic initiatives for you? Are you trying to grow revenue? Are you trying to increase customer satisfaction? Are you trying to increase the engagement of employees? What is it that you're trying to achieve? And then from there, we translate that into leadership behaviors. So we have research that tells us if you are looking to increase operational efficiency, it takes this type of leader and this set of skills. If you're trying to grow revenue or build product services, it takes this type of leader, this set of skills. And then we run the critical leaders through an assessment. So we place them actually in a simulation, and this actually grew out of the military, this approach. So we place them in a simulation for half a day, and then we observe what skills, what habits they already have. And what makes these simulations different, so it's not just watching videos, you're interacting with live actors. So you're really placed in this fictitious company. Think of it as a Harvard Business School case study come to life with these live role plays. So you might have an angry customer calling you, an underperforming employee calling you that you need to coach. Maybe you need to do a presentation for your board. So it's very much real life. And that's the key behind these assessments, because it's not just a questionnaire or survey that you fill out. We are actually testing you, testing your skills in a very realistic scenario. And that helps us understand what are the leader's strengths and what are their development needs. And then our software develops or designs a very specific development plan for each leader based on this assessment, so that you're closing the gaps that are necessary for them to achieve your business strategy. And we have an app that is based on the Leader Habit Book, and that app gives you daily exercises that you practice. And as you're practicing these exercises, it actually tracks your progress. So it works like a Fitbit. So maybe you started at about 50% when you took the simulation assessment, but now you've been practicing for 2-3 weeks, and you see that you have actually improved by 10-15%.
For the companies that engage PinSight, and initially, what's the tipping point for them to take and engage PinSight?
Yes, so generally it's changes, big changes in the business. So it could be a new CEO coming on board and needing to understand, do I have the leadership team to help me take the company where I want to take this? So in other words, do I have the right people on the bus, right? That's one of the key questions we get. Then an organization realizing that most of their executives are retiring in the next 2 to 3 years. That's another big trigger. Or general fed up with disappointment with the leadership programs that they have in place, and they want to try something different. And maybe their leadership programs are feeling stale, they're looking to refresh them, and that would be another trigger when they generally come to us.
So if you're coming into an organization, let's say it's an organization-wide need, then the assessment that you mentioned, whether it's role-playing, is role-playing necessarily brought in? Can it be driven by the software that you have?
It's all driven by software. So we have a software application that delivers all of this online. So nobody travels anywhere. They take the assessment, even with the live role plays from their home and office. We bring the role players through webcam to them.
Oh, okay. So the role players are used to playing difficult customers.
Oh, yes. That's all they do. That's their job, is to be a difficult customer, right?
And we're good at it.
Yes.
You know, I think about the company and, you know, the folks that are listening, and you're looking for practical transformation.
Yes.
Not just, oh, everybody read the book.
Yes.
What are you getting on feedback after these companies are going through this process?
Yeah, so we actually do research and longitudinal research, so we track the leaders over time. And what we find that, first of all, the assessments tend to be about 250% more accurate than job interviews than managers do, which makes sense when you think about all the biases that we have as people when we're interviewing people, when we're deciding, you know, who should be the successor or who should be promoted. And then from the development standpoint, most people tend to improve their skills in about 2 months. So you see that there's a visible behavior change that happens in about 2 months' time.
So I'm a company CEO and I'm listening to the podcast. And you go, you know what, I'm interested. So what's the process for the CEO? And then does the CEO get a compiled report? So what's that process like?
Yes. So as far as the buying process, so generally we would do a demo, and then we would identify the needs, scope out the project, and then move from there. And from an implementation standpoint, the analytics is really one of the most valuable things. So the most unique and exciting part about our software for me is that I can see very objectively on a dashboard the skill set of every single leader in my organization. But better yet, I can see how much they are improving on a daily basis. So I have access to real-time data of the skill set of people on my bus.
So you can tell whether they're playing or not.
Yeah. And who's serious about their development? Mm-hmm.
So, I'm thinking about the software, and I'm thinking about the CEO as they're doing the review. Let's say the organization has progressed through, mm-hmm. and everybody's moving up to speed. What's the biggest behavioral change that you see from the CEO now that he has this database at hand?
I wouldn't necessarily say behavioral change, but it is more of a comfort. So more of our ability to make better decisions and better decisions around the people side of the business. So you know as a CEO what are your key objectives and what you need to achieve. And the thing that really keeps most executives up at night, I found, is just having the right people to do it. Because you know that you cannot do it on your own. You need, especially in large organizations, right? You need fellow leaders and executives to help you achieve those goals. So it's the ability to have the right set of analytics, the right set of data to make informed decisions around having the right people in the right places to help you achieve what you need to achieve.
Is there a common weakness in organizations? Or are you saying just distributed weakness here there?
I found, incidentally, what I usually found when I do succession planning projects, and when we do this around the world, is that oftentimes when you put a group of leaders through an assessment, you found that the ones who have been picked as the official successors are usually the ones who are the farthest away from being ready. And there tends to be these diamonds in the rough that the company has been overlooking. But this process helps them identify those people that are really better fit and require a small investment and can be ready sooner.
Are you finding that's driving behavioral shift in succession planning?
it's driving conversations and it's driving reevaluation of the succession plans. Yes. So they are really looking critically at why have we selected these people and what are the biases that came into this, what are the internal politics, and they appreciate them much more objective, unbiased way to make these decisions.
How long has your company been around?
So I founded the company about 8 years ago.
Okay, and then the software came before the book, true?
Yes. So the first version, or the several first versions, I should say,
sure.
The several previous versions came before the book. It is last year that we released the new platform of our software that also now includes a whole development solution. So previously, before that, we were focused on the assessment side. But clients were often asking, well, we love the data, we can make the right decisions, but what do we do now?
What's the, if there's a prototypical size of a client, its employee of revenue, is there a prototypical client that serves best?
Yeah, so we usually work with organizations that have at least 100 million in annual revenue and up. So some of our bigger clients include AIG and CenturyLink, but we also work with some mid-sized organizations.
Your company, when I was looking into it before the show, you have employees everywhere.
Yes, that's correct.
Yeah, and your clients are also international, correct?
Yes.
So you're in Europe. Some regular basis.
Yes, I was last year almost every other month.
Do you find the acceptance rate or the different overseas than domestically?
Not necessarily. So we work with organizations all around the world, and that is really the benefit of having a virtual company and running a virtual solution, an online solution. We found, for instance, with one client, new CEO came on board, and very quickly they needed to assess 300 executives around the world so that the CEO could understand what kind of skill set was on his executive team. So with the previous kind of brick and mortar assessments, that wouldn't have been possible. But with a software solution, you can scale it very easily. But also, another exciting part for me is that you can streamline the process and be much more efficient if you play with time zones. And so previously, when I worked as a consultant, it took us about 2 weeks to get the results of an assessment back to the organization, to the CEO. Now it's a 24-hour turnaround.
You know, I think that would play so much in to be able to decide instead of waiting to decide. You know, I guess there's also the drawback is that you don't have time to perk on it a whole lot when the data comes back.
Yes, but when you are, especially in hiring situations,
yeah.
you don't have, if you find the right candidate, you want to move. You don't want to sit around and wait.
If you're a small organization, handful of employees, or you're the CEO of the effect of a small organization, would this be appropriate for the CEO trying to take in broaden his skill set or her skill set?
Yes, absolutely. So we have worked with some nonprofits, small businesses as well, and usually they are for smaller scale projects that focus much more on development.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think to shift gears here a little bit, now this is the point where I say quiz you to death, which just sounds depressing or mortal, but
no.
So for you, with your book coming out, what would be another book that you read or maybe most influential book that's altered your perception on being a CEO?
Yes, well, there, of course, the classics come to mind, like Jim Collins' Good to Great. I very much like the books by Heath Brothers, like Made to Stick. I think that was their first one, and then Switch. As a psychologist, that was one of the probably most influential books that I have read in the past, 10 years. So I would say those three, probably.
I was thinking as you were talking, as a psychologist and consultant in the business of helping businesses manage and lead better. How has that affected you? Because you're assessing and teaching.
Yes, yes, that's a very good question. You know, I founded this company straight out of graduate school. So it has been quite a journey of just learning how to be a leader and how to run a business myself.
Different than academia.
Yes, very much so. So I, you know, previously was a professor in psychology and in the business school as well. So I can tell that it really helped me writing about these models and talking about this research and leadership. I think you develop this special awareness where I wonder if it's almost detrimental, but you tend to analyze everything about what you're doing. You know, you analyze, well, you know, what did I say? What did I do? And is that part of the effective leadership library that we identified or not? You know, where could I improve? So you constantly think about this, and it can be, you know.
Doc, please fix yourself.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, looking back over your career, mm-hmm. and forming the company, what failure, or perhaps at the time, apparent failure, has served you or your company best and set you up for the achievement that you have now, and why?
Yes, I think I will answer this question differently. So I'll answer it from it wasn't necessarily a failure. It's more of a false expectation.
Okay.
So I think when most entrepreneurs start their business, there's this great excitement about how wonderful their idea is, and they expect overnight success. So we read about these stories of the garage startups, right, that are multi-billion dollar companies in just 5 years.
Exactly.
So as I reflect, and that's one of the things I've been thinking about lately quite a bit, is it doesn't really work like that. You know, you don't read about the 10 years of sweat and, you know, late nights and disappointments.
And missed flights.
Exactly. You know, that happened until the general public or somebody start noticing this business.
You're an overnight success.
Exactly. Yes. That's when it becomes the overnight success. But you don't hear about the 10 years that went into it. So that's one of the things that's been on my mind, and I think it's the lesson that I'm starting to internalize right now.
You know, thinking about that, so you kind of go, so you have the veteran of today, mm-hmm. all right? If that veteran of today could come back and talk to that rookie that was you starting your business, what advice would you offer to that rookie to cut a year or two off the journey? Is there any advice you'd offer?
Yeah, funny enough, so this is one of the advice that I give to our clients as well. And that is, don't focus or don't obsess on the results, the outcomes. It's a story from when I realized this is a story from my friend Rob, who is a big basketball fanatic. Told me about Coach Don Nelson, you know, if you're into basketball, but Coach Nelson was really loved by his players because he would never tell them just go out and win. What he would tell them is focus on the behaviors you've been practicing, and if you do them really well, good things will happen. So I think that is what I would tell myself of, you know, 8 years ago. And that's what I keep telling myself even today. That's what I keep telling our clients, is don't get discouraged. Don't get obsessed by the outcome, by the end result. Focus on the journey. Focus on doing the right behaviors. Because if you do them and you do them well, that's when success will happen.
Yeah, I think there's a couple of coaches down in the Southeastern Conference football world that talk about every player does their part really, really well, and then
right.
The rest works well.
Yes, yes.
So,
but
awesome.
It's about behaviors, right? At the end of the day, that is what we can control. You cannot control the economy. You cannot control market shifts, but you can control your daily behavior. that's what you should focus
well,
on.
Well, I think about that in, you know, in the innovation space. And so if you're controlling your behavior and, you know, you're in an industry where there's an enormous amount of innovation, so you could be innovated out of your market niche, mm-hmm. then as a behavior, what would you recommend the company do that's in one of those kind of climates where they could be taken out by the latest development?
Yeah, so there are several actual behaviors in innovation that we discovered in our research over the years. And one example would be celebrate experimentation. So don't shut down ideas, but get in the habit of celebrating them. So if somebody proposes the idea, new idea, different idea, even though your first reaction might be, well, let's just stick with what we have done because we know it works, learn to celebrate it. Because that's how innovation is going to happen. You have to start accepting new ideas. You have to experiment with those new ideas. Otherwise, there's no innovation.
You have to budget for it.
Yes. Yeah. But that comes later. Let's just get in the habit of not shooting any ideas down, but really celebrating them.
You know, if you could take and put an ad on page one of the local paper, either here or in Europe, sharing your company message or advice, what would it say and why?
So one ad on the cover. I would say invest in the people, invest in making them better leaders, because at the end of the day, that is what can make or break your business.
Yeah, what struck me about that is, so let's say I'm the CEO of the organization and we've gone through the process and, you know, everybody knows where they stand, and then they start making this journey. What do you notice in the behavior of the participants in the company?
So, of course, there's the behavioral change of themselves. So if the person is not good, for instance, in motivating employees or coaching their employees, you see behavior change in that regard. But I think more exciting for me is to see that people learn a new way how to develop their own skills. So there's a mind shift from I'm waiting for HR to send me to a course, and then I sit through a course and then miraculously come out a better leader. Or I read a book and then now I have better skills in coaching or influencing. So it's a shift, it's a realization that any success comes from hard work, and it comes from daily practice, and it comes from focus, laser focus, on particular things that we need to improve. And this process and the leader habit is very intuitive. We do this in sports, we do this in musical education, all around. But we don't seem to do that in leadership education.
Thinking about the businesses out there and the average person, where do you think the average person, non-military, gets leadership training from?
I think it's, so the research shows that about 30% tends to be genetic. So some people are more lucky than others in that regard, so 30%, but that still leaves 70%. It's life experiences. So when you think of habits as essentially ingrained automatic behaviors, we pick them up unconsciously.
Do you think they mimic previous employers?
They start, right, early on, they start with mimicking their parents, their teachers, key mentors, their managers as well.
So they could pick up bad habits as well as good habits.
Yes, exactly.
You know, it's an ongoing conversation that I have with many, and whether it's, you know, quality employee pool to hire from, or, you know, it's just we just have a challenge with the leadership profile of what we have in an organization, and then the kind of the conversation stops. You kind of go, we're not really exactly sure how to promote and improve and train in some measurable, meaningful way.
Right, yes. We don't think generally of leadership as a set of behaviors. We still tend to think of leadership as something magical, that just
George Pass.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But I think it's going back to that myth of overnight success. I think we have that in leadership as well, and that's a problem. As long as we subscribe to that philosophy, we're not going to see behavioral change, because success in business or in leadership doesn't happen overnight. It actually takes hard work, experiences.
Well, that's like the good public speaker. People assume, oh, they were born a public speaker. Rarely is a public speaker just born as a public speaker. Formal training, high speed coaching.
Yeah. I'll tell you an interesting story that was very related, kind of a shock for me. So I very much enjoy all the TEDx videos, and I was thinking about being a speaker and submitting a speech for one of those. So I got in touch with a person who was running one of the TEDx events, and we had a brief phone conversation just to understand the process. And I was absolutely shocked when he told me that they spent about 9 months rehearsing the presentation with a coach. But and at first it was I felt cheated, because when I was watching these videos without knowing anything, I thought, well, these people are just walking on the stage, they're absolutely brilliant, I'm fascinated by what they have to say. And then when I heard that, actually, no, that was really hard work. 9 months of really hard work that went into preparing that 15-minute presentation. But what I found fascinating was my first reaction of that feeling, this is cheating. Well, it's not cheating. It's hard work. And when you put in the hard work, the results are really positive.
My story is in the military, I had to brief a lot. Mm-hmm. And growing up in the South, speaking slow, accent, and my first boss had me rehearse. Larry Snyder, thank you very much if you're listening. had me rehearse and rehearse and rehearse. And it was just like for days to do the pitches properly on briefing military style.
Yes.
And you got to the point where it was by rote, it almost didn't matter what happened.
Yeah.
You knew where you were. And so, yeah, affected the output. You know, for you and the company, what is the best allocation of either time or initiative that's helped you or your company most, and why?
I will answer that from my personal perspective. I think this is what any small business owner, a CEO, founder of a small business struggles with, and it's the operations versus strategy. That tension has been, I think, is always there. So you have the daily issues and problems that come up, and employees that need support and clients that need support, but then you also have to set the vision for the organization. You have to be clear on the strategy, the direction that you want to take it, and that's one of the things that I've been working on a daily basis. How do you really reconcile this shift, and how do you dedicate time when you are focused on the strategy and the direction of the business?
I've had this conversation with many, the version between in the business versus on the business.
Exactly.
Who came up with the term?
I haven't heard that, but that's a very good way to describe it.
You think about it, so day to day, there's this and that, the meeting and the scheduling, mm-hmm. and the employees and all that other stuff, and then you go, I've got to shift gears, put on my strategic hat, and go, okay, now where do I want the business to be, and what's legacy, and I think about the on the business struggle, talking about a whole, that's book two. on it or
just that it. That would actually be a very good title for it.
And you think about the course differential, there's a CEO I know in downtown Denver, he said that was probably one of the bigger shifts for him a number of years ago, as we said, I went from billing to being on the business. He said 70% of my time now spent on it instead of in it. And it's been a watershed moment for them. And of course, maybe that has to do with delegation, to somebody you can trust and you can be honest with. Yeah.
Well, of course, I'm going to look at it from a perspective of leadership skills. So you need to be able to have comfort in the operations, and you have to have the right people there, and you to be able to delegate to them really well.
You know, it's interesting, years ago, in the military, I was working for some senior officers, and there was the command process, and you'd have all of the G staff level guys in the division come up, and they would have plans A, B, C, and D, maybe. And the commanding general would go, okay, I'd like part of A and part of C. And that would allow him to step back from the minutia planning and get a bigger picture of what he could do. And so that's really formalized in that environment.
Yeah, yeah. And it's a very good strategy to mitigate risk as well, having all those different plans.
As long as you surround yourself with people that don't say yes.
Yes. But you also need time to prepare those plans, right? And that's when the vision and the strategy comes again, is you need to be able to separate yourself out from operations to dedicate time to creating plan A, B, well.
And if you don't have the time, you've got to be able to train to react and have good muscle memory.
Yes.
All right. You know, for you, if I was to ask somebody, says, what's your most unusual habit, or what others may consider out of the ordinary, that's helped you or your company most?
Oh, this is a tough question. Habits. I'll tell you what people generally tell you about me, and that is not giving up. I don't know if it's like where that came from, or you know, my quality of resilience. And I'm thinking about what does that actually look like from a behavioral perspective, right?
And let me analyze myself.
Yes, here we go. Yes, but just that ability not to get discouraged when things are not going the way you want them to go, and then be able to change your thinking, look at it from a different perspective, and keep going, I think it's one of the habits that really helps with my business. So you know that, what is it, about 85% of new businesses fail in their first 3 years. And I completely understand why, living through that.
You have a notion of, I'm going to get to work for my own business and work for myself, and I'll be in control. And you go, I don't know what I was thinking, because that is not true. You know, and I think about so many of the business folks, you know, they're just tenacious to a fault. You know, I've heard it said, I'm too damn stupid to quit. You know, put your hat on backwards and go, okay, what's good about this? You know, there's been many books written about pivot.
Yeah.
And, you know, fail fast, which I'm kind of going on about that. But,
yeah.
You know, so there's all of those things, but your previous comment, where your advice to your younger self, you know, it's the process.
Yeah, yeah, it's the process. Journey. Yeah. I think the, you know, as with anything in life, there is no arrival. There is no, you know, ta-da moment when you say, oh, I'm here. No, it's always a journey, and there's always something else around the corner.
You know, over the past few years, what belief or protocol have you established in your company that has most impacted you or your company's success?
Focus. That is, I think if there is one thing that's behind our success, it's the laser focus and not get distracted.
So here we are, we're in a big company meeting by teleconference because they're everywhere. And go, all right guys, we're gonna focus, right? Okay, sure, fine. What does that look like? How do you communicate focus?
Yeah, so let me explain what I mean by that first.
Okay.
So what I mean by focus is that being very clear on what is our core business, what is it that we're doing, and what is it that is we are not doing. And it seems simple, and you hear a lot about this, and there are, again, a lot of books about that. But to internalize and to really start thinking about this on a daily basis and asking yourself, with every decision, is this part of our core business or not? And being able to say no when it's not, or finding ways how to outsource it, move it out of the business so that it's not really convoluting your operations.
Not everybody's your client.
Exactly, not everybody's your client. You know, not every leadership methodology is our solution. Not every person that we like is going to be an employee. You get the idea. So that's one. I have one more, and this comes from the Lean Startup, might be from other directories, that really spoke to me as a scientist. So the whole notion of looking at every single thing in the business as a hypothesis that needs data collection, needs evaluation before you move on to the next one. And then when I combine these two philosophies, so you have the focus, you have the hypothesis. So you need to have a very focused hypothesis in order to evaluate.
Prove or disprove.
Exactly. But the smaller you keep it, the quicker, the smaller each hypothesis, the quicker you can prove it or disprove it.
Which is back to your data collection from Pinside.
Yes, exactly.
Congruent, right?
Yes.
What advice would you offer to a new CEO that's assuming the role of CEO for the first time and why?
The first CEO, I would say just get a very clear understanding of the landscape, get a very clear understanding of the people, because you cannot get anything done in the business if you don't have the right people on board, and if they don't have the right skill sets. Probably, again, something that we hear over and over, but the people really are the most important.
Let's dig into that a little bit. So let's say you just got put into the role of CEO of a large company, and you're aware of Pinside. And you go, I have this tool. So I arrived here. I said, before I do anything, I'd like to have the whole organization go through this process. Have you seen that happen, or would you recommend it?
Not entire organization, but definitely the top executive team and then mid-level leaders. So that's where the biggest impact usually is. So if you don't have a solid executive team, then you cannot have a solid strategy because that's their job. And if you don't have a really good mid-level leadership team, then you cannot take whatever strategy you create and translate it into operational reality, because you don't have the people that can take the strategy and make it happen.
So for a new CEO, this might not be a bad toolbox.
I would recommend it.
Not that you're biased.
No. Of course not.
What are the most common misconceptions about you or your role as CEO?
Misconceptions. You mean from the perspective of employees? Or?
Yeah, I think so. You know, people say, well, you're the CEO, therefore.
Yes, you're the CEO, therefore you should be involved in everything or aware of everything. That's one of the common ones. And then I'm sure as many listeners can relate to, you get sucked into all these different detailed problems that you pretend to be interested in. But
that's another part.
Yes. There's another habit. So I think that would be one of the that you need to know about everything, or you need to be informed about everything. But I think that's also a habit of the CEO, is just being able to, say, this is how much information I need, and you can run with the rest.
You know, looking back over the past few years, what would or should you have said no to, and why?
There are definitely several clients and accounts over the years that I look back and say, we shouldn't have taken their business. And usually, now I can see those signs, but usually it's projects where there's not really buy-in. It's not really driven from the C-suite, and projects that are largely driven by HR or organizational development. If we're not working for the C-suite and for operations, the projects are generally not successful.
I've heard that many times.
I think it's with anything, Yes, we
leadership's got to get behind it.
Well, because it's about leadership. Who sets the tone for leadership? The CEO.
in the day-to-day operation of your company as CEO, what is your personal habit or self-talk dialogue that keeps you and the company focused?
So it's asking questions, right? Back to, is this core business? Is it not part of our core business? And then having clarity on that. So I would say that's one that I do repeatedly. And I do that not only to myself, but also in all the meetings. So when I meet, for instance, with the head of R&D, and we talk about the platform and what's new on the horizon, I always bring the question, what is it part of our core business or not? And then I think the other role is really acting as a coach and mentor and helping people get comfortable and help them to grow in the company. Back to the operations side, right? And if my leadership team is successful and has the right set of skills, that frees me up to focus on other things like the strategy, vision that I need.
The big picture.
The big picture.
I didn't ask. For folks that want to find you on social media or to reach out to you, how do they do that?
So I have a profile on LinkedIn and on Twitter. So those would be the two best media. Probably LinkedIn.
LANIK.
The last name is LANIK. Correct, okay. Yes.
All right, is there a quote that you find meaningful or that you use frequently?
There's one that is very popular at Amazon, and I'm thinking so that I don't mess it up. It says, "In God we trust, but everybody else needs to bring data." Is that how it goes?
I don't know
this
that's
one. Yeah. That I think speaks very much to my background as a scientist, and I think it's just really good decision making.
Hypothesis and proof.
Exactly. We don't make business decisions based on I think you think. No, we collect data, and based on that we decide.
And to get toward the tail end, now that I've worn you out, if colleagues were asked what you're best at, what would they say, and how do you utilize this particular strength on a day-to-day basis?
I would say asking questions. So that would be one of my best strengths, perhaps. So being able to ask the right questions to quickly get at the root cause of problems. And it has helped not only in decision making and problem solving, but also in helping people to grow, right? So very quickly being able to identify what are the strengths of different employees in the organization, different people, and then asking the right questions to help them think through the problems that they are trying to solve. So that ability to define a problem and identify its root cause, I think would be...
Back to the scientist.
Well, Martin, so I think we just gave a full circle of where we started.
Martin, I can't tell you how much I appreciate taking time. I tell you guys, if every day in Colorado looked like today, for those who can't see it, we have about a 270-degree view on this building. I can see Pikes Peak to the south. I can see the Front Range. It's all snow-capped. We have a bluebird sky. There isn't a cloud anywhere.
It's a beautiful day.
Beautiful
place
day.
To be.
And for those out there in the leadership space and are looking for some tools to try to take in and teach and move leadership through their organization, I would recommend the Leader Habit. It's worth the time to read, and I would take a look at Pinsight if you're trying to do some assessment and train your folks. So, Martin, thanks again.